Those that favor it, the widespread of it, and those that try to refrain from it and use it very little. Now, because of these two different approaches of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een with regards to ijtihad, the seeds of the two schools were planted, and the foundation for the two schools were planted. The two schools being number one, Madrasatul Ra'i. The madrasa, the school of reasoning. The foundation of this school was laid by Umar Farooq and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And the second madrasa we had was Madrasatul Hadith, the school of Hadith, and the foundation of this school was laid by Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And it is from these two schools that the four madhabs came from after a few years. These two schools were the foundations of the four madhabs which came afterwards, and the foundations of these two schools were laid by the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in themselves. So this was basically Islamic jurisprudence at the time of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in. After the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in, in the latter part of the reign of the four caliphs, there was a big fitna. What was this fitna? How it was caused? For this you will have to refer to the books of history. But what concerns is, because of this big fitna, sects and factions began to appear. And some of these sects began to rely on unorthodox interpretations of the Quran and Sunnah to suit their political views. And some of these sects began to fabricate hadith, the Shiites being one of the first to do this. How the ulama tackled the problem of fabrication of hadith, this in itself is a lecture in itself. But what we had after the reign of the four caliphs is that there were three main jama'ah. There was the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, there was the Shias who were inclined towards Sayyidina Ali and the people of the house, the Ali Bayt, and then we had the Kharijites who hated both. Now, because we had the split in the Ummah, they were not going to rely on things that the other people said. Thus, we had a split in fiqh, in the Islamic jurisprudence. We had the fiqh of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Secondly, we had the fiqh of the Shiites. And thirdly, we had the fiqh of the Kharijites. The Kharijites were the most strict from the three. To the extent, for example, for wudu, they believed that a person has to be pure from inside and a person has to be pure from the outside. This is why they considered things like hatred, jealousy, backbiting, lying, that all these things broke the wudu, and a person who did these things would have to redo his wudu. So went to the extent that they only relied on the Quran as the source of legislation and did not believe in the hadith of Rasulullah. These were the Kharijites. Then there were the Shiites who interpreted the Quran and Sunnah for their own benefit. Thus, and they believed that they will not take anything except from their own imam. Thus, they did not believe in this third source, the ijma, and they did not believe in qiyas, and they differed with Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah on many aspects of deen, masail regarding the inheritance, the nikah al-mut'ah, and the marrying of the Ahli Kitab, differed with the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah with regards to issues like this. That brings us to the fiqh of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, which concerns us today. In the beginning of the 2nd century to the 4th century, the beginning of the 4th. From the beginning of the 2nd to the beginning of the 4th, it was within this period of time, the four schools, the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah agreed upon, the Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi, and Hanbali school of thought, came into being within this period of time. It was within this period of time the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was compiled officially on government level, and it was within this period of time the fiqh was compiled and took form as a proper science. Now, the oldest of the four schools is the Hanafi school of thought. The Hanafi madhab, you can say, or you can say the school of Iraq. All the names basically mean exactly the same thing. The founder of this school was Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, Nu'man ibn Thabit al-Kufi. And the foundation of this school was laid by the Sahabi Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala. Now, I mentioned earlier that when the conquest grew, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in moved to different parts of the world to educate the Ummah and to guide them and to bring them to the Sirat al-Mustaqim. Many Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in moved to Iraq. Right? And the most knowledgeable from amongst the Sahaba who moved to Iraq was Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala an, and Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was one of the first to embrace Islam. He himself says that he was the sixth person to embrace Islam. And he was the first to recite the Quran aloud in Makkah al-Mukarrama. He stayed in the service of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He made khidma of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he directly acquired the knowledge of the sunnah and the knowledge of the Quran directly from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it was from companions like Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and Sayyidina Ali, people like Alqama, Aswad, Sha'bi, and Shuraih acquired their knowledge. And it was from people like this, Ibrahim Naqi acquired his knowledge. And from people like Ibrahim Naqi, the teacher of Imam Abu Hanifa, Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman acquired his knowledge. And from Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah acquired his knowledge. So this is the brief family tree, as you can call it, of the Fiqh Hanafi, the Fiqh school of thought. Abu Hanifa, Hamad ibn Sulaiman, Ibrahim Naqi, the Bit Tabi'een, Sahaba Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the family tree of the Hanafi school of thought. This is why when Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah went to the Khalif Mansur, Isa ibn Musa was sitting with him. Isa ibn Musa said to the Khalif, "This هذا عالم الدنيا اليوم. This is the biggest scholar of the world today." He asked him, "أما نخص العلم؟" Abu Hanifa, tell me who you acquired your knowledge from. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah replied, "That I acquired my knowledge from the companions of Umar, who acquired it from Umar. I have acquired my knowledge from the companions of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, who acquired it from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. The companions of Ali, who acquired it from Ali, and the companions of Ibn Abbas, who acquired the knowledge from Ibn Abbas." And this knowledge is the basis of the Hanafi school of thought and the Hanafi fiqh. Now, what happened at the time of Sayyidina Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah is that the governors began to take wrong advantage of the different opinions that were right and the different principles that were right, to the extent that they even began to force some of the judges to give wrong judgments. Because of this, this is just one of the reasons, and I have no time to mention the others. Because of this, Sayyidina Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah decided to compile the fiqh, and he was the first to do so. Now, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah not only decided to compile the solution to problems which had arisen, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah also decided to compile the solutions of problems which did not exist, solutions to hypothetical problems. And this was something new, because the people in Hijaz didn't believe this was a good thing. Because they believed that a problem should only be tackled when it arises. While Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah believed that the scholars should be well prepared. The scholars should think of the problems which the general masses may face, and the scholars should also at the same time think of the solutions to these problems. So when the general masses face these problems, the scholars are not new to these problems. The scholars already have the solution to these problems, and the scholars are able to guide the masses to the Sirat-i Mustaqim. And the reason for this was that the era of Imam Abu Hanifa was such that the borders of the Islamic State from one side had reached Russia, and from the other side it had reached Spain. We had Turkish Muslims, we had Iraqi Muslims, we had Kuwaiti Muslims, we had Yemeni Muslims, we had Misri, we had Spanish Muslims. All these different types of Muslims, they've got their own cultures, they've got their own system, they've got their own patterns of behavior, they've got their own methods of transaction. And all these things required an answer from the Islamic point of view. Are these things permissible? And especially Baghdad, because Baghdad at the time was the capital of the Islamic State. And all these different people were coming to Baghdad. So when Abu Hanifa rahimullah realizing this problem, not only decided to compile the solution to problems which had arisen, but solution to hypothetical problems. And the way he compiled this fiqh was that he had chose 40 of his best students. Now, Imam Tahawi, the master, relates on the authority of Asad ibn Firas, who was a student of Imam Malik rahimullah. He says these 40 were such masters, that each and every one was a mujtahid in himself. Had reached the ijtihad, status of ijtihad. And these are the 40 he chose to compile the fiqh. This is why Waqi ibn al-Jarrah, he was a master of hadith. He says, how is it possible for a mistake to remain in the works of Abu Hanifa? Why? Because he had masters in qiyas like Zufar, Muhammad and Abu Yusuf with him. He had masters in hadith like Yahya ibn Abi Zaida and Hafs ibn Ghiyas with him. He had masters in the Arabic language like Qasim with him. And he had people like Fuzail ibn Iyad, who nobody could match in piety and taqwa. He says that whoever's companions are these type of people, he cannot make a mistake. And if he does make a mistake, then these people, رُضُّهُ إِلَى الْحَقِّ, they will turn him to the truth. So these were the type of people Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah had chosen to compile the fiqh. Now how he compiled the fiqh was that he would relate a problem to his students. And the problem and the students would solve, try to solve this problem. And the sources they used to solve the problem, yet again, was the Qur'an. If not found in the Qur'an, the sunnah of Rasulullah. If not the sunnah, third came the ijma of the sahaba, the unanimous agreement of the sahaba. If not from there, then the individual opinion of a sahabi. If not from there, then came qiyas, analogical deduction. After qiyas came istihsan, preference. After istihsan came urf, local custom. This is the sources that they used to solve their problems. Now if all